Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh our Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity until this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelations given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and Canada in certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach by the true and correct names and title for the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifest in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been improperly substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that they're Lord's many and God's many. But we now know each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a J in the English language since some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and correct name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, he is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see, this fiery cloud has been drawn to extend all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. In like manner, everything in the creation and the sum total of the universe abides within this pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within himself as Elohim. This is the word, our Son. A super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up your one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First, is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second, is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, is to investigate the unexplained spirit law of the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating a mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning, ordained. There is no other name given among men whereby a man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth, is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in a new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We have a prayer this evening by Dr. Samuel Salas and a scripture lesson of Revelations, the third chapter, by Dr. Bud Wunsch. Mm-hmm.
good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for allow us to be here tonight and make possible for bring ourselves and learn more about you, purpose, and your plan. There is too many things in my mind I can ask for, like health for my friends and myself, and keep us in good shape. That way we can keep coming and learn your words. I say all those things in your only sign name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say,
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Tonight's scripture will be taken from the third chapter of Revelations. I'll be reading to you from the Holy Name Bible. This Bible was critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trena. He happened to be an Italian Jew, and he was with the Scripture Research Association Incorporated. This particular Bible was reprinted by Yahshua Promotions. Revelations, the third chapter. And he said unto the messenger of the assembly in Sardis, write, these things saith he that hath the seven spirits of Yahweh and the seven stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die. For I have not found thy works perfect before Yahweh. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not block out his name out of the books of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the assemblies. And to the messenger of the assembly in Philadelphia write, these things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hath kept my word, and hath not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say, they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I will also keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world, to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man taketh thy crown. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my Elohim, and he shall go no more out. And I will write upon him the name of my Elohim, the name of the city of my Elohim, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my Elohim. And I will write upon him my new name. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the assemblies. And unto the messenger of the assembly of the Laodiceans write, These things saith the I Am, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of Yahweh. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and appoint thine eye with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in unto him and will sup with him and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and are set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the assemblies. Revelations the third.
Our first speaker this evening will be the dean of the school, Dr. Joe Williams.
Good evening, class.
Good evening, Joe.
Good evening, class. Good evening. It's always a pleasure to stand before the assembly of Yahshua Messiah and testify. There's some of the things that Yahweh allowed me to see and understand about this great teaching. I enjoyed the scripture lesson. I'm glad to see you all out today. I hope something is said here to inspire everyone to want to come out and study, not only on a Friday night, but on a Tuesday night as well as a Sunday night, to learn all you can about this great teaching. You know, so we also have a returning visitor. I want to make sure that we lay a brief foundation so that our visitor will get an understanding about what we're all about, what this teaching is all about. Mm-hmm. Now, before I start, what I want to do is look up a word I want you to keep in mind as we're teaching. And that is the word embodiment. I want you to look that embodiment.
Okay.
Yeah. I want you to look that up. Keep that in mind. Yeah. That is M. I think I spelled this right. Is that right?
Looks right.
Embodiment.
Right.
I want you to look that word up before we get started. Because it's important that we keep that in mind while we're talking. And I want the moderator to read the first aim of the school in just a second. And I also want 1 John 5:7-8, King James Version, please. I think I better get this to you. Okay. Let me know when you get that word embodiment.
Embodiment.
What are you reading from?
Random House Webster.
Oh, you got the right one? Is that the right one? Yeah, you want to get it out of that one. That one, that other book kind of, sometimes it get a little shallow on the details.
There we go.
Yeah, you kind of modify, take away a few things and take a little bit of the power out of it. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But that one you have right there, dictionary, should give us exactly what we need. Mm-hmm. Well, while we're getting that word, let's have the first aim of the school. Now, this is what the first aim of the school is all about. And this is what our founder, Henry C. Kelly, who had a divine vision of revelation in the year of 1931, said he had a vision direct from Yahweh himself. Mm-hmm. He said, don't believe it because I said it, but you make me prove it to your satisfaction. Mm-hmm. Now, prior to him coming to his divine vision of revelation, he was in the Church of God in Christ for about 15 years. And they say he was a bibliomaniac. He knew the Bible backwards and forwards. You could be quoting the scripture, you can quote the one above it and below it. Mm-hmm. He also had the gift of healing back in those days. And there's one thing he had an issue with, and that is, how is it that there are two works of grace? Mm-hmm. You know, in one place it says you have to believe, you see, and then another place says you have to do works. Mm-hmm. So which one is it? You see, that's what he pondered in his mind. Mm-hmm. And there is a scripture that stayed on his heart and mind. I believe that's in Acts 17 and 30. You know, which we probably could get that too a little later on. But at the end of the day, Yahweh blacked him out one day, and he gave him a panoramic, stupendous vision, you see, of Yahweh's divine purpose and pattern and plan of salvation. And what you see pictorially illustrated around this room is that vision that he had. And this did not come from no ordinary man. He could not do or paint something, you see, this stupendous. And what he said was, you make sure you make me prove it to your satisfaction. And after he had that vision, he was taken upstairs, he was elevated. Mm-hmm. And that's when he received a revelation. Now, a revelation, a vision without a revelation is no good. Mm-hmm. You have to have a vision and also have a revelation. Now, he wasn't the first one to have a vision. Joseph Smith had a vision. Those are the Mormons, you see. But he did not have a revelation. You see, then there was Ellen G. White. She had a vision. Those are the Seventh-day Adventists.
Right.
But no revelation. A vision without a revelation is not going to do any good. Now, when Yahweh wants to contact a man, he always sends someone to warn the people at the end of the age. Now, at the end, you see, of the post-Diluvian age, you see, because from the fall of Adam down to the flood, that is the antediluvian age. That's the age before the flood. Age is synonymous to the word world, and an age is approximately 2,000 years. Mm-hmm. Diluvian means flood, and of course the word anti means before. He sent Noah at the end of the age, you see, and we know that Noah was 480 years old when he received the vision, and he preached for 120 years. The year of the vision was 2348, and we also know that he passed from death unto life. There was eight souls that got into the ark, and they moved over into the post-Diluvian age, or the age after the flood. And Noah lived to be 350 years, you see, on this side of the flood, and he died. Now, at the end of the post-Diluvian age, Yahweh sending his own son, in the likeness of sinful flesh, you see, to fulfill and to bring to a complete close of what he purposed and he declared way back here in the realm of eternity. So he sent his son, Yahshua Messiah, in the likeness of sinful flesh to warn the people. You see, and at the end of the age, he got up on that cross and he dispensed grace. Now, from the fall of Adam all the way down to the cross, that is 4,000 years. Okay? Now, where you are right now, this is what we call the present kingdom age. You see? Now, there are three ages that operate within the realm of time. That is the antediluvian age, the post-diluvian age, and the present kingdom age, where you sit right now. Mm-hmm. And then you, and what is this, 2017? Mm-hmm. That's where we are. Mm-hmm. Okay? Where you are within the scheme of time. Mm-hmm. Okay? Now, I'm going to validate visions in just a second. Okay? Mm-hmm. Read. Embodiment.
Embodiment. One that embodies the act of embodying, the state of being embodied. The other one was better, I think.
Oh, which is that embodied?
No, this dictionary. I thought that was
better. Because yeah, that's not what I want.
Right.
A tangible or visible form
of an
idea, right, quality, or feeling. The representation or expression of something tangible, or visible form.
Got this? All right. That's it. That's it. This thing on?
This
guy. Yeah.
Go ahead and read that again.
Embodiment.
This is embodiment.
A tangible or visible form of an idea, quality, or feeling.
Okay, read on.
The representation or expression of something in a tangible or visible form.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's good enough right there. Now, with that being said, what we're looking for is a creator.
Mm-hmm.
You see, of heaven and earth, who is invisible. And the question is, how is it that he's going to reveal himself to mankind? Okay? And the way he does that is by way of a vision. And he also gives you a revelation. It's important that you have a divine vision and a revelation right now where you sit.
Right.
All right? In order that you may see and understand Yahweh's, listen, in his, in his infinite wisdom, he has prepared a way or an avenue for us to know him as he really is and as he has exists.
Right.
You see, and our first aim is to help you find O Yahweh, our Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't say find Yahweh. It says find Yahweh, our Elohim,
right,
as he really is and as he has exists. Right. Now, it was important for me to impart and get this across tonight about Yahweh, our Elohim, because this is the one who is the true and original teacher.
Mm-hmm.
Now, 1 John 5:7-8, please. Let's read. Now, this is what we call the Godhead. Sometimes it's called the supernal nature.
Mm-hmm.
What do you mean by that? The supernal nature is the Father, the Word, the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. And sometimes that is called the Godhead. Now, we know that the Father does have a main name, and the moderator already told you that the Father's name is Yahweh.
Right.
You see, we also teach in this school that Yahweh is the ultimate source, the substance, the limits, the bounds, and the origin, and the essence of all things, not some things. You see, he is incomprehensible, he is inscrutable, and is indiscernible to the natural senses of the man. Nevertheless, Yahweh purpose of purpose, way back here in the realm of eternity, with you in mind. And we also teach, we try to get across, you see, is that Yahweh is both masculine and feminine within himself. He does not have to go outside of himself to create or to procreate.
Right.
It is within Yahweh that we all live and we move and we have our beings in him.
Right.
Okay? Now that's what we're going to talk about tonight. Yahweh and his purpose and how he's getting that cross to the man. How he's manifesting himself to all of mankind to know him as he really is and as he actually exists. You see, and that is done by way of a vision, you see, and you receiving a revelation. Now, 1 John 5:7-8.
King James.
Read.
For there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, mm-hmm. the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one.
Now, there's three that bear record in heaven. The Father, the Word, and Holy Spirit. Now listen, this is an immutable, indelible record. That is the Father, Yahweh. You see, the Son, Yahweh Elohim. You see, and the Holy Spirit, which is Yahshua Messiah. You see, so the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, these three are not three, these three are one. It is the one Spirit who is Yahweh. Mm-hmm. All right? I didn't say two spirits. I said the one Spirit, you see, is Yahweh. And encouched, you see, in this Spirit is His divine substance of intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. This is His divine makeup. You see, this is what He is, yet He abides therein. And listen, we talk about Yahweh having characteristics. He's inscrutable, incomprehensible, you see, indiscernible to the natural senses. But out of love for you, Yahweh, you see, purpose within Himself, you see, and providing an avenue for us to know Him by doing this. He purposed the purpose with you in mind, because He knows you would not understand Him in His abstract state or in His ontological state of perfection. As Yahweh the Father, pure spirit, you see, incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. So it behooved Him to come into a state whereby the man can understand Him in His incorporeal state condition. Or this is Yahweh who is pure spirit incarnated, or Yahweh in pure spirit in a manifestation or in a representation as Yahweh Elohim, who is the archetype or the original pattern of the universe. Because you cannot see Him, you cannot understand Him in His abstract state. And as the moderator said, this cloud goes all the way around the edges of the chart to show you how everything that is on this chart abides within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe. And when I say universe, I'm talking about the angelic or the spiritual realm, as well as the physical creation. It abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Y'all with me so far?
Right.
Now, most people think the universe is just simply the creation, the things that we see. The two makes up the universe. The spirit and the physical, or the spiritual realm and the physical realm. Right. Your body is a witness of that, and that you have a physical body, but you have an inner man that you cannot touch, you cannot handle, you cannot see, you cannot smell, you understand? You cannot sense with your natural senses this inner man that you have. However, that is Yahweh Himself in you, as you, hidden from you. You follow me? I'm talking about the spirit or the soul. You see, that is Yahweh. Nevertheless, the two, the physical body and the inner man, that makes up the universe. Your body is a miniature construction of the universe. You are a microcosm of the great macrocosm. Everything out there is also within you. You are a threefold universal spirit pattern with an immutable spirit law right where you sit. You see? And it is Yahweh Himself that is abiding in you, trying to get you to see Him as He is in you as you. You see? That's the reality of the teaching. Nevertheless, He takes something natural and physical to give you to look at, to get you to see something about the invisible Yahweh. Nevertheless, Yahweh is the Father, being both masculine and feminine within Himself. That makes Him the parent substance. So He is pure spirit in His abstract state, but He's also in two manifestations, incorporeal and corporeal, invisible and visible. So there's three to bear record in heaven, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. The one Spirit in two manifestations, within and without. You see? Now, Read, please. 1 John 5:7-8.
8th verse. And there are three that bear witness on earth.
Now there's three witnesses on the earth. Read.
The spirit.
Uh-huh.
The water.
Uh-huh.
And the blood.
Uh-huh.
And these three agree in one.
It did not say these three are one. It says these three agree in one.
That's right.
You see? Now, let me say it like this. We as the man, we have blood in us. You see, we have water in us, mm-hmm. and we also have the spirit within us.
Right.
If we become born of either one of those, as the book says, he will come as a thief in the night.
Mm-hmm.
You see, now that don't mean somebody flying in, you know what I mean? Pete, you get my point? Mm-hmm. He'll come to kill you.
Right.
He will come as a thief in the night.
That's right.
You see, and people get that all twisted. I hope I don't want to get to that tonight. But the point is, these three agree in one. They are not one, but they agree in one. They work in harmony.
Right.
All right? Now, read on.
Okay. If we receive the witness of man.
If we receive the witness of man, read on.
The witness of God is greater.
Now, the witness of Yahweh is greater, which is the spirit and the water, the spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree in one. Read on.
For this is the witness of God which he had testified of his son.
Read on, please.
He who believes in the son of God has the witness in himself.
Now listen, I just said that, did I not? That you have spirit and you have water and you have blood with you.
Right.
You are a witness that there is a creator.
That's right.
You know, some people are atheists. Agnostics.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end of the day, you are a witness that there is a creator. What are you talking about? If there is a creator, I'll put it like this. If there's a creation, you see, there has to be a creator. Yahweh being the creator created creation, and then he created a creature, and then he himself took up residence in that creature and walked around in his own creation as that creature. The problem is that you don't realize that you are that creature.
Right.
You see, walking around in a creation. Yahweh in you as you. You see. Now, to get that understood, we're going to draw that out a little more. Read, please.
He who does not believe God has made him a liar.
Read on.
Because he has not believed the testimony that God had given of his son.
Read on.
And this is the testimony that God has given us eternal life.
Come on.
And this life is in his son.
This life is in his son. So we're going to look to this one here that's hanging on the cross. You see? To get you to see something about Yahweh and his divine purpose. But more importantly, about who you are.
Mm-hmm.
Doctor, don't make sense for you to walk around on the airplane, you don't know who you are.
That's right.
That you think it's you're whoever you're, whatever your name is, Jack, Joe Blow, Sally. You see? Somebody said, well, who are you? The only thing best you can do is say your name.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's just a word you answer by.
Mm-hmm.
You see? But the question is, what is your origin? Where did you come from? What is this creation all about? Where are you going when you die? What happens on the other side? What is the soul? What is the spirit? Why is it necessary for all of us to have a vision? You have one whether you're conscious of it or not anyway. You see? Now, quickly. 2 Corinthians 3:17. And then also I want you to go real quickly over to John 1 and 1. I want to validate this. That's a great idea.
King James.
Second Corinthians
3:17.
Now Yahweh is spirit.
Now Yahweh is spirit.
And where the spirit of Yahweh is,
uh-huh.
there is liberty.
Now, I didn't say that. The book says Yahweh is spirit. Mm-hmm. And where the Spirit of Yahweh is, there is spirit. Well, where is that? Everywhere. Mm-hmm. He is omnipresent. Mm-hmm. There is no place that he's not. Mm-hmm. Yahweh is light unto the air. Mm-hmm. He's in you and he's without you. Mm-hmm. Just as the air is in you, the air is also without you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You see, and you are a witness that there is a Yahweh. Because your manifestation and your breathing in and out is a witness and declaring his name. Mm-hmm. Yahweh being both masculine and feminine within himself. Now, since I said that, I know I called John 1:1, but I want to go real quick over to Ephesians 4:4, please.
Ephesians 4:4.
Read, please.
There is one body.
Now look, there's only one body.
And one spirit.
And there is also one spirit. Come on.
Even as ye are called in one hope of your calling.
Come on, read on, please.
One Elohim.
One Elohim.
One faith.
One faith.
One immersion.
One immersion. Now listen, it says there's one body. All right? Mm-hmm. That is him. That these attributes, you see, this is what you call a spirit embodiment. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm going to see if I can get another dictionary. My phone works real well. I have a really good one on here. Mm-hmm. Because I want to make a comment about this. See, the arrangement of these attributes, that is his body. Mm-hmm. In other words, what we have here is intelligence flanked by wisdom and knowledge. Beauty giving birth to love and justice. Foundation giving birth to power and strength. That makes up this Elohistic body. Now this is what I'm talking about. That is a spirit embodiment. You have intelligence flanked by wisdom and knowledge. You have beauty flanked by love and justice. You have foundation flanked by power and strength. All right? Mm-hmm. Now, do this right?
Tree.
Toast.
I didn't mean to get, do that. I need to.
He says, sees man as trees.
Yeah, tree. That's close. Yeah.
Arms and legs.
There you go. Mm.
Christmas
tree. Did I do that right?
Yep.
Okay. Intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge, that's the crown.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, strength makes up his body. You see, that is Yahweh Elohim standing on the earth plane. Mm-hmm. Okay? And that's what we're going to go into by when we get over to Moses. That is one spirit and one body. Now, we got Yahweh, you see, who is spirit, taking on shape and form as Elohim. Who is the archetype and original pattern of the universe. And encountered with this in the spirit embodiment is the angelic and physical creation. And as he called Moses up into this mountain, reveals himself to the man, Moses. Remember, the waters, the animals, the creation was already here. So Moses is seeing a rerun of how the creation come in by the pattern. Mm-hmm. You see, and he is seeing this this super incorporeal anthropomorphic being, which is Yahweh Elohim himself, or Yahweh himself, in part, not in totality, taking on a shape and a form and revealing himself to Moses. This shape and form, this is the word. This is what he's talking about. There's one spirit, and there's one body. and there is one faith. Mm-hmm. Because there is only one faith, that's him, that's Yahshua Messiah. There's only one body, that's him, that's Yahshua Messiah. You see, and he's trying to show you how that Yahweh Elohim himself, as he's coming in, he transformed into the threefold completely furnished tabernacle, having nine furnishings pointing to the nine divine attributes, and then back into himself. And he's showing Moses how he's manifested as cosmogony, you see, as chaosis, as the first day, the second day, the third day, the fourth day, and the fifth day, and the sixth day. But in between each one of these days, these hearts here you see here on this plate represents a man. That is Elohim. This is the Word. Or it is the Son. Now, let me have John 1:1, please. Finish up Ephesians.
In the beginning was the Word.
Finish up Ephesians real quick.
One is Yahweh,
the
Father of all, who is above all, and through all, and in you all.
That's good enough right there. Read on, please.
In the beginning was the Word.
Now, in the beginning was the Word. Read on.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
The Word was with Yahweh.
And the Word was Yahweh.
This very same Word that you see was Yahweh. Not another, not a separate one. Because what Christianity teaches, they're the Trinity. There's God the Father, there's God the Son, there's God the Holy Spirit. But what we're trying to get you to see that Yahweh is a unity, not a trinity. You see, he's the one spirit in two manifestations, incorporeal and incorporeal. So in the beginning was the Word, the Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh. Read on.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
This same Word was right at the beginning with Yahweh. Read on.
All things were made by
him. All things were made by the Word. Read on.
And without him was not anything made that was made.
Read on, please.
In him was life.
Now in him the Word was life. Read on.
And the life was the light of men.
Because this was the spirit that took up residence in Adam and bringing the purpose right on down. Mm-hmm. All right? Read on. 14th verse.
14th verse.
Read on.
And the Word was made flesh.
And the Word was made flesh. Read on.
And dwelt among us.
Read on.
And we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
Now see, the Word was made flesh. Mm-hmm. The Word, Doc, is not the Bible.
Right.
The Bible is the express revealed will of Yahweh.
Right.
Now let me just validate that. Let's go back to Genesis 12 and 1. And I want somebody to pick up Hosea in the Law and the Prophets. Mm-hmm. How about 1 and 1?
Genesis
12
and
1.
Now Yahweh had said unto Abraham.
Now they're always talking to Abraham way back here, who he gave the promise to. Read, Lee.
Get thee out of thy country.
Read on.
And from thy kindred.
Read.
And from thy father's house.
Come on.
Unto a land that I will show thee.
Come on, read on, please.
And I will make of thee a great nation.
Read.
And I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, mm-hmm. and curse him that curses thee.
Read on.
And in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed.
Now go to 15 first. 15 and 1.
16.
15.
15 and 1?
15 and 1.
Okay. After these things, the word of Yahweh came unto Abram in
a vision. Now it says, after these things, the word of Yahweh came unto what?
Abram in a vision.
And he started talking. It didn't say the Bible come to him. It says the Word came unto him. Mm-hmm. You see, because the Bible is not the Word. Yahweh Elohim is the Word.
Right.
Read, please.
Saying, fear not, Abram.
Read.
For I am thy shield and thy exceedingly great.
The Word talks. It speaks without any audible sound. Let's read on, please.
And Abram said,
read.
Yahweh Elohim, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house.
That's good enough right there. I just want to make a point that the Word talking, the Word is way back here with Abraham. Mm-hmm. You see, when the Bible had yet not been assembled. Now, pick a Hosea 1 and 1. Let's read, please. Now, we went to the Law. Now, we're going to go to the Prophets. Because remember, the Law is the first five books of your Bible, correct? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. You see, that's the first, which was written by the man Moses. And then from Joshua on down to Malachi is the prophets. one witness to the other. Whatever is written in the law is confirmed by the prophets. What's in the prophets is confirmed by the law. All right? Now, let's read over here. You got to read something about that word again. Read.
The word of Yahweh that came unto Hoshea, the son of Beeri, in the days of Uzziah.
That's good enough right there. My point is, the word was back there with the prophets as well. Mm-hmm. You see, the word is not the Bible.
Right.
The word is the express revealed will of Yahweh. 2 Peter 1 and 19. Make it 1 and 20. Y'all gonna make me run out of time. We're trying to get somewhere.
2
Peter, yeah. 2 Peter 1 and 20.
1 and 20?
Yes, knowing this verse.
Knowing this verse.
Read on.
That no prophecy of the scriptures of any private interpretation.
Come on.
For the prophecy came not in old times by the will of man,
mm-hmm.
but holy men of Yahweh spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit.
Now, you know how people say, well, I don't believe in the Bible because it contradicts
right.
itself.
Mm-hmm.
And man wrote the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Peter says, holy man of old spake as they was moved by the Holy Spirit, meaning this, the man himself had nothing to do with it.
Right.
It was always Yahweh Elohim himself that was penning everything.
Yeah.
It was him that got into these men, told them what to write, how to write, and when to write,
right.
because he used them just like I'm using this pointer, or like you pick up a pencil, and he's telling them what to write. But they didn't do anything on their own.
Right.
You see, pick up 16 in that verse.
16.
1 and 16. Read on.
For we have not followed cunning device fables.
Read on.
When we made known unto you the power of the coming of our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah.
Come on, read on.
But were eyewitnesses of his majesty.
Now, the reason why he said that, because Peter, and I'll understand now, that Yahshua's autobiography was written in the law and in the prophets.
Mm-hmm.
You see, and he told us what he's going to do before he manifested in the earth plane. That's why he said, we're not coming up with any cunning and devised fables.
Mm-hmm.
You see?
Mm-hmm.
Or something made up. Let's read, please.
For he received from Yahweh the Father honor and glory.
Read.
When there came such a voice to him from the exceeding excellent glory.
Come on, read on.
This is my beloved son in whom I am well
pleased. Now he's talking about how John baptized him. You see, when he identified who Yahshua Messiah was, when the dove sinned, it said, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased.
Yeah.
Read, please. Come on.
And this voice which came from heaven
we
heard when we were with him in the holy mountain.
Read on.
We have also a more sure word of prophecy.
Now he said we have also a more sure word of prophecy, talking about Yahweh Elohim. Read on, please.
Whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place.
Now the dark place is the man's consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
You see, he himself is the light of lights. It is him in you that's illuminating your consciousness, if you will. You see, revealing himself to you. Read on, please.
Until the day dawn and the day arise in your heart.
Now, the day dawn is like the sun. It rises every day. Read on. Now, the sun we're talking about is Yahweh himself, which is the S-O-M. He needs to rise in your heart and in your mind. You see, revealing himself to you. Read, please.
Knowing this first. That no prophecy of the scriptures is of any private interpretation.
Read on.
For the prophecy came not in old times by the will of man,
mm-hmm.
but holy men of Yahweh spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit.
Now everything that you read in the Law of the Prophets was by way of Yahshua Messiah, who is the Holy Spirit. Now, John 14:26. Now this is
comforter.
Now hold it now. This is the Messiah walking around in Palestine, Judean hills. This is what he's saying. Read, please.
But the comforter.
Read.
Which is the Holy Spirit.
Uh-huh.
Whom the Father will send in my name.
Read on.
Shall teach you all things.
Mm-hmm.
And bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I had said unto you.
Now, this is Yahshua saying. But the comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, who I will send in my name. He's telling you right there, his name is Yahshua.
Mm-hmm.
You see? Because, see, he said, I come in my Father's name.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The Father's name is Yahweh. You see, similarities in these names. Shua just means salvation. It just means Yahweh is salvation. So, Yah the masculine portion, you see, Way of the feminine portion. You don't see no similarities in these names. Lord is the title, God is the title. Jesus is the false rendition of the true name Yahshua. It's a combination of a Greek sky god, Zeus, and a Babylonian deity, Ian. You see, that's where that name comes from, or the origin, if you will. And then Christ means anointed one. You see, but he is Yahweh. I'll put it like this. Yahshua is Yahweh's anointing. That's why he's called Yahshua the Messiah. The Messiah means Yahweh's anointing. You should be saying Jesus the Christ, because Christ means anointing. But Messiah means Yahweh's anointing. That's why we say Yahshua the Messiah. Right. But there's no similarities in these names. Now you know that Lord has a title, and all lords have names. You see, your landlord has a name. Over in England, the House of Lord has a name. All those guys have names. And you know that every god has a name. You see, Zeus, Thor, Hercules, Achilles, all gods have names. And whatever culture what you embrace, those gods too, they also have a name. All right? But the true name, you see, of your creator, it is Yahshua, meaning Yahweh is salvation. And that's why he manifested himself in the 4,000 year or in the fourth millennium in the earth plane to fulfill that the sun that being placed in the heavens, it was placed in on the fourth day. One day with Yahweh is 1,000 years, 1,000 years is as one day. You with me so far?
Yes.
Now, with that being said, let me have John, the 5th chapter, start the 39th verse, and we're going to move on. Because I want to make a point. I got to validate the visions. 39, yes, please.
Ye search the scriptures.
Read on.
For in them ye think ye have eternal life.
But they are they.
They are they which testify of me.
Now here the Messiah walk around in Palestine, Judean hills in a physical body. You see? And he's telling the Jews or the Sanhedrin Council to search the scriptures. For they think they have eternal life. Because they thought they can keep this law. The 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances. They thought they could adhere and keep this law and have salvation. And they sought to kill Yahshua Messiah. Let's read, please.
But ye will not come to me
read.
That ye might have life.
Come on.
I receive not honor from men.
Read on.
But I know you that ye have not the love of Elohim.
Now he says, I receive not honor of man because, listen, I'm the one who created you. You see, and I understand your thought, your motivation, and your intent. Let's read, please.
Mm-hmm. I am come in my Father's name,
read.
And ye receive me not.
Now, we already talked about the Son's name is Yahshua. You see, the Father's name is Yahweh. Read, please.
Let another come in his own name, him ye will
that's
receive.
That's Buddha, that's Allah, you see, whatever. Mm-hmm. What is his name? T.D. Jakes, Freddie Price, Cleflo Dollar, everybody buy all that.
Mm-hmm.
But every man on earth, they all have fault. There's nobody on the earth that does not have fault. Mm-hmm. Top, from the top to the bottom. Mm-hmm. I don't care what order is, what discipline, what culture, what city, what continent, what state you're on. All mankind has fault. Mm-hmm. You see, and if you do not seek him for your answers and your redemption, I'm letting you know you're going to waddle around in darkness until Yahweh reveal himself to you. Now let me say this. You don't have to come up in here to know Yahweh.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But this is the way that Yahweh provided for you.
There you go.
Everybody in here had a divine invitation at some point in time.
Right.
You just didn't walk up in here because you felt like walking up in here. Yahweh himself invited you in.
That's right.
To come and partake of, you see, his grace. That's why he says, I stand at the door and knock. If any man, you see, hear my voice, open up the door, and I will come in and I will sup with you. We read that in the book of Revelation. And then the Messiah himself says, I am what? The door. You see, and we have a door in our pattern right here that lets the fulfillment of him coming in and saying, he is the door, walk around. You see, and it's him who's going to knock on the door. He's just saying, let me in so I can teach you.
Yeah.
All right? Let's read, please, because I got to move.
How can you believe which receive honor one of another?
Read on.
And seek not the honor that cometh from Elohim only.
Read on.
Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father.
Come on.
There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom ye trust. For had ye believed Moses, ye would have believed me.
Read.
For he wrote of me.
Now, Moses wrote about Yahshua. You're not going to find his word, Jesus, nowhere from Genesis down to Revelation. If that is so, we will shut the school down. Because Jesus was never back there with Moses, but Yahshua was. And Moses did write about Joshua the son of Nun, because Joshua and Yahshua are one and the same. Let's read, please.
But if ye believe not his writing,
read on.
How shall ye believe my words?
Read on.
And the Jews marvel, saying, how knoweth this man letters, having never learned?
That's good enough right there. So we go back to Moses to try to get an understanding of Yahweh's divine purpose. Because where I'm heading for is up in this garden where Moses actually had the vision. You see, now we're going to go back to Exodus, the 24th chapter. We're going to pick that up, and maybe I should start the burning bush, because that's what the founder said, do. Start the burning bush.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm being basic tonight, okay? But I want to try to get some meat in here. Let's pick it up at the third chapter, pick it up at the burning bush here.
Exodus 3rd chapter.
Now listen, we back here with Moses, because Yahshua said go back to Moses. Let's read, please.
Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law,
mm-hmm.
the priest of Midian.
Read on, please.
And he led the flock to the backside of the desert,
mm-hmm.
and came to the mountain of Elohim.
Read on, please.
Even to Harod.
Read on.
And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him.
Now there was an angel in this bush. Come on, reading. Read.
Appeared unto him into a flame of fire.
Now it says this bush appeared in Moses' consciousness. Let's read.
And he looked.
Read on.
And behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed.
Read on, please.
And Moses said, I will now turn aside to see this great sight, while the bush does not burn.
Now, Doc is not like the book. He just said he's looking at the bush. He said, but now I got to turn aside to see this great sight while the bush does not burn. Yahweh have to get his attention. Read, please.
And when Yahweh saw that he turned aside to see,
read.
Elohim called unto him
read.
Out of the midst of the bush.
Where
he said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I.
Now there's a conversation in the bush. Had you been standing there, you wouldn't have seen this. Mm-hmm. You see, but that was all going on within Moses' consciousness. This is Moses having a vision. Let's read, please.
And he said,
read.
Draw not nigh hither.
Read.
Put off thy shoes from off thy feet. For the place whereon thou standest is holy ground.
Now, he says, Moses, take off your shoes. You got the shoes up here. Mm-hmm. And what happened, Yahweh want to deal with the man's soul, the S-O-U-N. But on the bottom of his feet, he have a soul. You see, so it's a way of showing homage. Mm-hmm. You see, humbling yourself. So you take off your shoes, because you want to deal with the man's soul, the S-O-U-L. Mm-hmm. Read, please.
Moreover, he said,
read on.
I am the Elohim of thy father,
uh-huh.
the Elohim of Abraham,
read.
The Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim.
Now look, at this time, no man on the earth plain knew the name Yahweh. Mm-hmm. Nobody called him El Shaddai. They didn't know him as Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
They knew him as the El Almighty Provider. Let's read, please. Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh said,
read.
I have surely seen the affliction of my people.
Now he's letting Moses know. I know what's going on down here in the land of Eden, how these people are in bondage down here. Mm-hmm. You see? And don't be surprised, I'm the one who put them there. Let's read, please. Mm-hmm.
And have heard their cry by reason of their taskmaster.
Come on, read.
For I know their sorrow.
He says, I know what's going on down here. They're enslaved, mm-hmm. and they are also in bondage. Let's read, please.
And I am come down to to deliver them out of the
now look, we ain't gonna read over that. He says, I have come down mm-hmm. to deliver them mm-hmm. out of the land of Egypt. Get Yahweh out of the sky, folks.
That's right.
You see, he's not above the sun, moon, and stars like people suppose. He says, I have come down to deliver them out of the land of Egypt.
Yeah.
Read, please.
And I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians.
Read on.
And to bring them up out of the land.
Come on.
Unto a good land.
Read.
And a large unto a land flowing with milk and honey.
Read on, please.
Unto the place of the Canaanites
uh-huh.
and the Hittites.
Come on.
And the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites.
Read.
Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come unto me.
Now he said, now you look. The cry of the children of Israel have come unto me. Because Joseph prophesied that Elohim would surely visit you. But now it's time. Read, please.
And I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppressed them.
I ain't got time, but see, the Egyptians, they were in bondage. But they did not know they were in bondage. It's just like you walk around in bondage in these bodies. Enslaved in these bodies. But you don't know that you're in bondage. Come on, there got to be more than just getting up, going to work, and going back home. Watch this TV. Mowing your lawn. Going to the grocery store, putting gas in the car. There got to be more to it than just that. Because some people think, I'm happy. And this is what they do. Or out there, you know, the farmer, what they do? Plow.
Yeah.
Every day. That's it. It got to be more to it than just that. Let's read, please.
Come now, therefore.
He said, now come, therefore, read on.
And I will send thee unto Pharaoh.
Come on.
That thou mayest bring forth my people.
So now he's going to commission Moses to go down to the land of Egypt. Now Moses just fled from down to Egypt, the land of Egypt. He was born down here in the land of Egypt, and he was in Pharaoh's household for 40 years. He was raised as his stepson. You see, but after he killed that Egyptian and buried him in the sand, you see, Moses had to make an exodus out of the land of Egypt to divide into the wilderness of Sinai. He didn't swim the Red Sea, but he went by way of the Philistines, which is the trade route. And that's how he got out here, you see. And he's out here for 40 years, you see. 40 when he left, now he's 80 years old, and Yahweh revealing that vision to him. All right, let's move, please.
And Moses said unto Elohim,
read,
who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh?
So he's making excuses. Come on, why can't you choose the guy next door? Why me? Read.
And that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt.
Read.
And he said, certainly I will be with you.
He said, now look, Moses, don't you worry about a thing. Certainly I will be with you. You ain't doing nothing. You just look like you're doing something. But remember, Moses is having a vision. And Joshua the son of Nun is down here in the land of Egypt, projecting himself up here and talking to Moses, or appearing to him in his consciousness and telling him to come down here to live the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, you see, just as I purposed and declared back here when you're in Canaan's land. Now let me validate that real quick. 15th chapter of Genesis, let's read quickly. Now, what I want you to see is that there was a promise made to Abraham that in his seed, singular, that all the families of the nation shall be blessed, both Jew and Gentile. Now, anybody that's not a physical Hebrew is considered a Gentile. I would think if anybody in this room is not a Hebrew, then you are considered a Gentile in Yahweh's eyesight, if you will. All right? Now, let's read, please. But the promise was to Abraham, seed, singular. You see? Not plural. But read on, please.
After these things, the word of Yahweh came unto Abram in a vision.
Now, that wasn't the Bible talking to Abraham, but let's move on.
Fear not, Abram.
Uh-huh.
I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward.
I apologize. 15 and 12.
And when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram.
Read on.
And lo, an horror of great darkness fell upon him.
Read.
And he said unto Abram, know of an surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs.
Read.
And shall serve them.
Come on.
And they shall afflict them 400 years.
Now listen, they're going to go into a land that they know not of, and they're going to serve these people. They didn't know that was going to be Egypt. That's how they got down there, because Yahweh purposed for them to go down there. Let's read, please.
And also that nation whom they shall serve,
which are the Egyptians. Read on.
And afterwards shall they come out with great substance.
Now when they leave, because they can go down there, but they can also come out. You see, read, please.
And thou shalt go to thy fathers in peace.
Read on.
Thou shalt be buried in a good old age.
That's good enough right there. Let's head back where we left off at. Back over there in Exodus. I just want you to see how they got down there. They started up here in Canaan's land, and they went on down, but they also had to come back up, because there's a descending and there's an ascending pattern that's going on. Just like your blood circulates throughout your entire body. You see, it goes to your heart, it goes, leaves your heart, it goes to your lungs, it comes back to your heart, and then it leaves your heart and go to all parts of your body, coming on back
to the heart, to the lungs, to your body. It's just a cycle. It says a descending and an ascending and a circulating. So the children of Israel had to come down into the land of Egypt. Then they had to also go back. You see, you had to come down from heaven, but now you want to go back to heaven. Why? Because your destination is your origin. You see, you come forth from heaven, then you're going to go back to heaven. Now, when you come down to a land you know not of, you see, that will place you in darkness. You see, these people in Canaan land came down here to the land of Egypt. That was not their land, but they were in darkness. They were in bondage. They were enslaved. In the same state and condition that we're in when we don't know Yahweh.
Right.
We are in darkness. We're enslaved. We don't know who we are. We don't know where we're going. We just know we're in this world to the point that we become materialists. We don't even believe in the Creator. If they're the creation, they got to be a creator. Mm-hmm. If they're the creature, they got to be a God or a creator of that creature. Right. Okay? Let's read, please.
And he said,
read.
Certainly I will be with thee.
Read on.
And this shall be a token unto thee.
Now listen, we're going to read over that tonight. All right? Mm-hmm. Moses not going to go down here and confront Pharaoh because he killed that man down there. Mm-hmm. And he saw this light. And he's telling him, certainly, Moses, you go down here, you just do what I tell you to do. Mm-hmm. He says, and certainly I will be with you. And this is how you're going to know it. Read.
And this shall be a token unto thee.
This shall be a token unto you, Moses. Read.
But I have sent thee.
Read.
When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt,
mm-hmm.
it shall serve Elohim upon this mountain.
Now look, when you go down there, and you confront Pharaoh and do as I say, and you bring these people out back out of the divided waters of the Red Sea and bring them back to the waters of Sinai and serve me upon this mountain, you know it was me doing it.
Right.
It was not you, because you can't do it. So certainly I will be with you. I will be communicating with you the whole way what's going on and what's happening. Speed this up. Yahweh tells Moses to go down into the land of Egypt and to confront Pharaoh. And he's obedient, but he also told him to take this name with you. Let's read, please.
And Moses said unto Elohim,
read on.
Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel,
mm-hmm.
and shall say unto them,
read on.
The Elohim of your fathers had sent me unto you.
Read.
And they shall say to me, what is his name?
Now listen, Moses had enough sense to ask God for a name.
Mm-hmm.
Now if God was his name, and Moses was talking to God, why is he asking God for a name if God is his name?
Mm-hmm.
And some people will fight you tooth and nail saying that God is his name.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing that God is a title.
Mm-hmm.
Just like a policeman, mm-hmm. a police officer, every officer has a name, every fireman has a name, every nurse has a name, mm-hmm. every doctor, those are titles. God's title the same way.
Right.
You see, so Moses had enough sense to ask for a name because he knew there was plenty of gods down here in the land of Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
You see, and those gods being down there, these people, they worship these gods, many gods. You follow me? Let's read, please.
What shall I say unto them?
Now, let me say this. Abraham was the first man that believed in monotheism.
Right.
That is, one God.
Mm-hmm.
You see, it was the Hebrews lineage that came through Abraham.
Right.
So from Adam, you with me so far? All the way down to Abraham, that was 21 generations. You follow me? And from Abraham on down to the cross, that was 63 generations. Yahweh put that in your physical body. You have 31 pairs of cranial nerves, you see, peripheral nerves coming down out of your brain, okay? 31 pairs, you see, making up 62. But there is one called the final terminale. That is making up 63,
mm-hmm.
showing that there are 63 generations coming down, you see, on down through the ages and dispensations. You are a witness to that. You follow me? Let's read, please.
And Elohim said unto Moses,
come on, read.
Eya Asher Eya.
Uh-huh.
And he said, this shalt thou say unto the children of Israel.
Now, for our guests, most books says, I am that I am.
Mm-hmm.
That is a mistranslation.
Yes.
What he said was, translated, Eya Asher Eya, which translates, I will be what I will to be.
Mm-hmm.
You see? So therefore, if he said, I am that I am, that is a limited statement. I got this stick in my hand. If this stick says, I am that I am, when I cast it on the ground, it's going to still be a stick.
Right.
But if this stick says,
I will be what I will to be, Yahweh have to demonstrate his power and also establish Moses' faith. So when he told him to cast that rod on the ground, it turned into a serpent.
Right.
Demonstrating that I can be a rod on the ground, you see, or a serpent on the ground. He told him to pick it up by the tail, then it turned back into the rod. I will to be a serpent on the ground or a rod in your hand. Right. He also told him to put his hand in his bosom to take it out. It was an incurable disease. Told him to put it back in his flesh, in his bosom, and this time he plucked it out and it was as his flesh. Mm-hmm. I can be an incurable disease or I can be as your flesh. I be what I will to be. I will to be the sun, moon, and the stars and all things therein. That is me too. And let me say this while I'm here. When you look at this tree here, you see, the question is, does that tree have life? And when you look at a mountain over here, the question is, does that mountain have life? And I'm saying, yes, it does, for this very reason. That mountain is made up of these divine attributes of intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. This is energy itself. And when he manifests as the entire creation, it is functioning in Yahweh's purpose as he sees fit. He declares if it's going to be the sun, and the sun function as the sun. The stars function as the stars. The planets function as the planets, and the rock. And do you understand what I'm saying? It functioned as that in Yahweh's purpose. You see? So therefore, the energy and the life that's in it is the spirit that makes it up. That's why we have atoms. You can't see them. You see? But that's also Yahweh's carrying out his purpose through nature, if you will. All right? Let's read, please.
Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I will be has sent me unto you.
Read on.
And Elohim said, moreover unto Moses, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel.
Now tell them this. Read.
Yahweh, the Elohim of your father, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob, has sent me unto you.
Now he talks about Abraham's seed. Remember, Abraham had two sons, Ishmael and Isaac. Isaac had a set of twins, Esau and Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons, and his name was changed from Jacob to Israel after he wrestled with an angel one night. And Israel means power with Elohim. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now when you see the Israelites, they're talking about the descendants of Jacob, which are the sons of Jacob, or they're Israelites. They're the descendants of Israel, who is Jacob. You see, and it comes from his seed, if you will. That's why you got 12 tribes, because he has 12 sons. You see, because Yahweh is setting up his purpose for the man to look at. So, we got a pattern that we're operating by, you see, and which what we're trying to get to is explain how this pattern operates. Let's read, please.
This is my name forever.
This is my name forever.
And this is my memorial unto all generations.
Now, he said the name is Yahweh, who is the source and substance. He said, this is my name forever and a memorial to all generations. I would think that we are a generation of people. Mm-hmm. All right? It does not change when a J comes into an existence. Right. All right? Now, 6 and 3. Exodus 6 and 3, and then we'll move on.
6 and 3. And I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob as El Shaddai.
Read.
But my name, Yahweh, was I not known to them.
So prior to Moses, nobody knew the name Yahweh.
Right.
I just want to make sure I validate that. Now, Yahweh sent Moses down the land of Egypt, and he poured out 10 devastating plagues. Okay? The 9th plague was stench of black darkness, and the 10th plague, of course, was the plague of death. You see? And listen, the firstborn of all male and beasts, man and beast, going to die in each household that does not have the blood of the lamb on the door. Because Yahshua says, I am the door. So the death angel would pass over the house, would have blood, and the blood had to be on the top of the door, the two side posts. It was different from a basin, which we're not going to read that. That's in the 12th chapter of Exodus. You see, and listen, everybody, all Jews had to partake of that lamb.
Right.
That lamb had to be in you in order for you to make an exodus out of the land of Egypt. Now there's a 3-day journey to the Red Sea. Now remember, there's three tenets we try to get across. One, that's the name. The second is the institution and the fulfillment of Yahshua Messiah. Whatever Yahshua is doing,
It had to be fulfilled, had to be instituted someplace. Because fulfilled means to complete or to bring to an end as of a promise. Mm-hmm. And in this respect, you see, Yahshua had to get on that cross. And that lamb had to be killed. Mm-hmm. So they had to kill the Paschal lamb. And that lamb had to be without spot and blemish. Why? Because Yahshua Messiah, Pilate said, I can find no fault with them. You see, and the blood was on the top of the door, the two side posts different from a basin. Likewise, Yahshua had a crown of thorns on his head, likened to the top of the door, the two side posts likened to his hands, and he was nailed in his feet. So that is likened to the basin. Now, there is a fifth point of blood where they pierced him in the side. You see, well, when they killed that lamb down there, you found they had to also pierce that lamb and drain the blood on him before they put the blood on the lintel, the two side posts, and dip it from a basin, making up 4 points of blood. But this is in fulfillment of this event that took place back here with the children of Israel. You see, what happens to this lamb has to also happen to this lamb. You see, he says, I am the door, so they have to put the blood on the door. This is the institution. This is the fulfillment. Everything is pointing to him. So we got a door in our pattern, so therefore he has to come in saying, I am the door. And so therefore we have to also find a door also back here. Now, can you read, please?
Come where?
Where are we at?
Well, we left off in...
Go to... Jump over to Exodus to 24th chapter.
24th?
Yeah, because after they partook of the lamb, okay, they had to prepare themselves to get up out of there. You see, there's a 3-day journey to the Red Sea. Now, the reason why the 3-day journey to the Red Sea, because in fulfillment, Yahshua had to be in the heart of earth for 3 days and for 3 nights, in fulfillment of these 3 days. You see, they had to go through the Red Sea. You see, and that door, that Red Sea tunneled up like a door. Mm-hmm. You see, because there's a door also in our pattern. Now, in that we got a pattern, Israel have to understand they're moving by the pattern, but they're not conscious of the fact that they're moving by a pattern, right? Mm-hmm. So when they get out here, they gather around this mountain, and Yahweh says, I'm going to speak to them. Mm-hmm. You see, he tells Moses, gather the people up, you see, and I'm going to speak to them. So what he speaks is, he speaks that law. You see, that 10th commandment law, which we're not going to read tonight, and it's not like the book where they had, the movie where they had five laws on one side, it had five laws on the other. You see, it was 3 laws on one side of the table of stone and 7 on the other. Why? Because Yahweh is the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and these 3 are one. And then there are 7 days of creation. We got a pattern. It has a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about, representing the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But there's also 7 steps to this tabernacle, with the gate being one, because you got to come in. The altar of sin sacrifice, where the high priest, where the animal was sacrificed on this altar. You see, he would take the blood from the priest and put it on the 4 corners of this altar, because it represents the earth plane, because there's 4 pools of gravity, north, south, east, and west. Likewise, there is a grave that's also on this pattern right here, like into the earth plane. You see, you have the earth, you have latitude, but you also have longitude. That almost right?
Yeah.
That's like into the grave. Now, you walking on the earth plane, you are the sacrifice on the earth. Likewise, there had to be a sacrifice also on this altar. You see, this is step 2. Then 3 is a washing, you see. In this labor, the high priest would wash himself, but he also would wash the animal as well. You see, now this is likened to your rivers and your lakes and your seeds here. Because see, and then the door, you see, is your 4th step in your pattern. So you got 1, 2, 3, 4 is the door. And the cup of holy anointing oil is the spirit that was actually at the door. Coming to the holy place itself and all its contents, the 7-branch golden lampstand, the table of shewbread, and the altar of sacrifice, incense, makes up, you see, the 5th step in your pattern.
Right.
And see, you have also a 2nd veil, which is likened to the 1st. Because in reality, the 1st veil, which is blue, purple, and scarlet, makes up, which is the door, if you will. It wasn't a door like this here. It was curtains. You just part and go through.
Mm-hmm.
See, but all these contents make up the holy, the 5th step in your pattern. But the 2nd veil is a 6th step, which points, of course, to the flesh, which is also blue, purple, and scarlet. And the 7th step is also, in reality, is the most holy place where the Ark of the Covenant is. Now, that's 7 steps, you see.
The gate, the altar, sacred sacrifice, the brazen laver, the door is four. The holy place and its contents is five. The second departure veil, middle veil is six. And the seventh step, of course, is the Ark of the Covenant, or which is the most holy place. So you got seven, but you also have three. So I'm trying to show you principles. Yahweh, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
There's 7 days of creation. There's three compartments, but there's also seven steps to your pattern.
Okay.
The three, ten devastating plagues, the first three was experienced by the Egyptians as well as the Hebrews, but the last seven was by the Egyptians only. Showing forth that pattern and that principle is moving all the way down through the ages and dispensations.
Right.
Now, they come through the dividing waters of the Red Sea, and Moses told the guys around this mountain. And he said he's going to speak to them. Now let's pick that up in the 24th chapter of Exodus. 1.
9.
Exodus 24 chapter.
Read.
And he said unto Moses.
Read on.
Come up unto Yahweh.
Uh-huh.
Thou and Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu.
Here we go. Read on.
And 70 of the elders of Israel.
Read on.
And worship ye afar off.
Read.
And Moses alone shall come near Yahweh, and they shall not come nigh.
Read.
Neither shall the people go up with him.
Now he says, Moses, you, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and the 70 elders, you see, come up to the mountain. But they need to stay at the plateau of the mountain, but you're going to come a little further, okay? But they have to stay down here. But let's read, please.
And Moses came and told the people of the words. And Moses came and told the people all the words of Yahweh.
Read.
And all the judgments.
Read.
And all the people answered with one voice.
Read.
And said, all the words which Yahweh hath said will we do.
Now people said that all that Yahweh said we will do. That was a marriage. All right? Let's read, please.
And Moses wrote all the words of Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
and rose up early in the morning and builded an altar unto the hill.
Now jump down to 8 and 9.
And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people,
mm-hmm.
and said, behold, the blood of the covenant which Yahweh hath made with you concerning all
the
gods.
This is the first covenant.
Right. Mm-hmm.
When he dedicated the book with blood.
Mm-hmm.
That's the first covenant. You see, that book was placed in the Ark of the Covenant.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but that was the opening of the first covenant, establishing it right there. Let's read, please.
Then went up Moses.
Mm-hmm.
Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu.
Read on. Come on.
70 of the elders of
read.
Israel.
Now read.
And they saw the Elohim of
the book Israel. Said they saw God.
Mm-hmm.
Alright? Now, there's another place where it says they didn't see God.
Right.
Alright? Now go to John 1:18. And I want you to read that out the King James Version. This is why people don't believe in the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
Because they say it contradicts itself. Mm-hmm. Let's read, please.
No man has seen God at any time.
Now, here it is. John 1:18 says, no man has seen God at any time.
Mm-hmm.
Here we read where 74 people said they saw God.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now, how do you reconcile that?
Mm-hmm.
You got to put the true names back in.
Yeah.
No man has seen the Father, Yahweh.
Because right.
mm-hmm. Yahweh is spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And spirit is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible to the natural senses.
Mm-hmm.
You see? But you can see Yahweh Elohim.
Yeah.
That is by a way of a vision
right.
and a revelation. Because this is him in his incorporeal state condition as he takes on shape and form and appears to the man. Now, let me also validate that. Numbers. No, I'll do it in a minute. Keep reading.
No man has seen God at any time.
Read on.
The only begotten Son who is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him.
That's good enough. So we made the point. You got to put the name back in. Otherwise, you'll never understand the Bible.
Right. Hmm.
No man has seen pure spirit at any time, but they have seen Yahweh, our Elohim.
Right.
You see, as the Word or Son, he appeared, and we read where he talks and he speaks to the man. Now, head back over to Exodus, the 24th chapter, and keep reading on down.
Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu.
Read.
And 70 of the elders of Israel.
Read on.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel.
Read on.
And there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone.
Read on.
And as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness.
So we got God having feet, And he have a body, right? Read on, come on.
And upon the nobles of the children of Israel, he laid not his hands.
So we know God have feet, body, and hands. Let's read, please.
Also, they saw Elohim and did eat and drink.
So they see God, and he said they did eat and drink. Now, they weren't eating food, real food. What they was partaking of was his sustenance, okay? Or his sustenance. Let's read, please.
And Yahweh said unto Moses,
read on.
Come up to me into the mount.
Read.
And be there.
Read on.
And I will give thee tables of stone.
Read on.
And the law and commandments which I have written, and thou mayest teach them.
So now Yahweh's inviting him up. Let's read.
And Moses rose up, and his minister Joshua.
Now the question is, what's he getting his butt up for? Read, please.
And Moses went up into the Mount of Elohim.
Now the question is, keep reading.
And he said unto the elders,
come on, read.
Tarry ye here for us.
Read.
Until we come again unto you.
Read. He said, tarry ye here for us. Until we, what?
Return.
Come again.
So, obviously, they both went up.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the question is, who told him to come up? We just read what he told Moses, mm-hmm. to come up alone and by himself. But it said him and his minister Joshua invites him up. Now, the founder said this, that Joshua, or Jesus being back there with Moses, was the greatest mystery that was perpetrated upon mankind. They don't understand that Joshua, the son of Nun, that is Joshua, whom the world calls Jesus Christ, back there with Moses, you see? And it was him that was orchestrating this whole thing with the children of Israel on down here, going down the land of Egypt, through the bottom of the Red Sea, and into the wilderness, you see? Now, let me show you what I'm talking about. Pick up Numbers 12 and 1, and pick up Exodus 33 and 7. We want to talk a little bit about who this one Joshua, who the world calls Oshia, the son of Nun. They didn't know him back there because he was hid. Just as Joshua was hid from his people back here, they didn't know that was God of everybody. They thought that was Mary and Joseph's boy. So if he was hid, it's because Joshua, the son of Nun, was hid back here. They didn't know who he was. Hmm. They would ask him, who was that? They said, oh, that's old man Nun's son. Well, see, and people say, well, he was a Hebrew, but I'm letting you know, he wasn't a part of the 12 that came out of Jacob's loins. He said, those were the Hebrews. But let's read on.
And Miriam and Aaron spake against Moses.
So Miriam and Aaron spake against Moses. Let's read.
Because of the Ethiopian woman whom he had married.
Now it seemed like to me, who I married is none of your business. Whoever I feel like marrying, that should be all right with me. We call that front load. You know what front loading is, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I care about you and I love you very much. I'll do anything for you. But everything's important is after the but. But I prefaced it with all this stuff. Mm-hmm. But the most important thing is what I was saying.
Right.
But I'm mad at you because, you know, you get my point?
Right.
Now let's read. So now they're talking about Moses' wife. Read, please.
For he had married an Ethiopian woman.
Read, please.
And they said, has Yahweh indeed spoken only by Moses?
That's the problem. Mm-hmm. Does Yahweh speak by Moses only? Mm-hmm. And not by us? Let's read.
Hath he not spoken also by us?
Come on, let's read.
And Yahweh heard it.
Wait a minute. It says Yahweh heard it. Mm-hmm. Now, he could have been above the sun, moon, and stars. Mm-hmm. He was right there with them.
Yeah.
In this tent back here.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, see, as Hoshea, the son of Nun. It is as Yahweh heard it. Let's read, please.
Now the man Moses was very meek.
Come on.
Above all the men.
Come on.
Who were upon the face of the earth.
Read, please.
And Yahweh spake suddenly unto Moses.
Now he talked to Moses. This is what he said. Read on.
And unto Aaron.
And uh-huh.
And unto Miriam.
Now Miriam was his sister and Aaron was his brother. Mm-hmm. You see? And they all jealous because Yahweh's dealing with Moses and not with them. Let's read, please.
Come out ye three.
Now he said, you three come out to the meeting tent. Let's read, please.
Of the congregation.
Come on.
And they three came out.
And they came on out. Read on.
And Yahweh came down in the pillar of cloud.
There it is right there. That pillar of cloud came down on the tent that was on the back side of the mountain. Now, let's read.
And stood in the door of the meeting tent.
Now, they stood in the door of the meeting tent. Let's read.
And called Aaron and Miriam.
Now, look. Yahweh, Yahshua, the son of Nun, he says, you two come here. Read.
And they both came forth.
Read.
And he said,
read.
Hear now my word.
He said, now you listen to what I'm telling you to. Read on.
If there be a prophet among you,
uh-huh.
I, Yahweh, will make myself known unto him in a vision, and will speak unto him in a dream.
That's why Moses is having a vision. That's why these people right here are having a vision. You understand? That's why all the prophets are having a vision. Because that's the only way you're going to see Yahweh, Elohim, that is, in a vision, if you will. When he spoke to all the prophets, it was by a vision, you see. And the revelation had to come later, and that was at the promise. Let's read, please.
My servant Moses is not
so. He said, but my servant Moses is not so. Read on.
Who is faithful in all my house.
Read on.
With him I speak mouth to mouth.
He said, I speak mouth to mouth. Read on.
Even apparently.
Read.
And not in dark speeches.
Now, that's good enough right there. So he's going to make himself known in vision. Now, go to Exodus 33 and 7. We want to identify who he is. Read, please. Because the question is, why is he getting up? Now, Doc, come here for a second. I'm going to be Moses.
Okay.
And you're going to be Yahshua. You, God in the body. Now, you invite me up to the mountain, and we go up to the mountain together. The question, am I coming along by myself? Mm-hmm. Of course he is, because I'm here. He's the one that invited me up.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, Moses coming along and by himself. But it looked like two people going up to the mountain.
Right.
But he's God in the body, inviting Moses up into the cloud.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Have a seat.
Simple as that.
It's that simple. Mm-hmm. You see, it's just like if I invite you to my house, I say, you come by yourself. I'm picking you up over at Winchell Donuts. Next thing I know, you got two, three people. Hey, I told you to come by yourself. You see? But if we two go into my house, just you and I, then you come in by yourself. That's what we got right here. You see? Now, we want to identify who he is. Read, please.
Exodus 33 and 7.
Read.
And Moses took the tabernacle.
Read.
And pitched it without the...
He took the tabernacle and pitched it without the camp. Read.
Afar off from the camp.
Now, the tabernacle is called the tent. A tabernacle is no more than a temporary dwelling place. That's what these are. They're temporary dwelling places.
Mm-hmm.
You see? And what they would do, and that cloud, they would tear this tabernacle down, and they would follow the cloud, and when the cloud stopped, they stopped, and they'll still the tabernacle. Likewise, when your cloud stops, right,
mm-hmm.
you go to sleep.
Mm-hmm.
You see? And when your cloud wakes up, guess what? You wake up with it. When it says get up and go pee, you get up and you go pee.
Right.
It says go. You're hungry. You're right. Whatever your cloud tells you, that's what you do. You don't tell yourself when you got to go use the restroom, and you don't tell yourself when you're hungry. Your cloud tells you that.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Let's read, please.
Mm-hmm. And called it the meeting tent.
He called it the meeting tent. Read on.
And it came to pass
mm-hmm.
that everyone which sought Yahweh went out unto the meeting tent. Of the congregation.
Now, if you want to sought Yahweh, not above the soup, my son going to start, but in the tent. You with me? Let's read.
Which was without the camp.
Read. Look, we got it right over here. These people were gathered up all the way. Their tents were gathered around the tabernacle. But this one here was way far off on the back side of the mountain. That's the meeting tent.
Mm-hmm.
You see, Moses would go in there on a regular basis. Read, please.
And it came to pass
Read.
When Moses went out unto the meeting tent
mm-hmm.
that all the people rose up
Read.
And stood every man at his tent door.
Now you know how we are when the police come. Everybody come out and they roll in their pajamas. The lights roll and they want to know what the heck's going on. When that cloud would come down, then you know. These people would stand at their tent doors and they want to know what's going on at the meeting tent. Let's read.
And looked after Moses.
Come on.
Until he was gone into the tabernacle.
Read on.
And it came to pass, as Moses entered into the meeting tent.
Now the tabernacle is called the tent, and the tabernacle the one the same. Let's read, please.
The cloudy pillar descended.
Now the tent, read on.
And stood at the door of the meeting tent.
Read.
And Yahweh talked with Moses. And all the people saw the cloudy pillar stand at the meeting tent door.
Read.
And all the people rose up and worshiped.
Read.
Every man in his tent door.
Read.
And Yahweh spake unto Moses face to face. As a man speaketh unto his friend.
Now he says, Yahweh speaketh to Moses face to face, just like a man talking to his friend.
Mm-hmm.
Let's read.
And he turned again into the camp.
Read.
But his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, departed not out of the meeting tent.
Read on.
And Moses said unto Yahweh.
Now that ought to tell you who that was right there.
Mm-hmm.
who was in the meeting tent, who was the one orchestrating all that, all the event. That's why when Moses went up in the mountain, it says Moses and his minister Joshua, they went up in the mountain. And when they get up in this mountain, it was Joshua the son of Nun that transformed before Moses.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses saw this Elohistic body and how Joshua transformed into this tabernacle. See, Joshua the son of Nun was Yahweh Elohim manifested in the flesh.
Right.
Yeah. You see, as Oshia the son of Nun. Mm-hmm. You see, and it was him inviting Moses up into the mountain. It was him blacking Moses out. And he's showing Moses, you see, his glory, if you will. And then he transformed into this tabernacle, you see, and then back into himself and into cosmogony. Back into himself, into chaosis. Back into himself, into the first day. And Moses witnessed how the creation is being assembled by a pattern. How he separated the light from the dark. You see, with the twilight in the midst, the water above, the water beneath, the firmament in the midst, all the way down to he made the man, spirit, soul, and body. Mm-hmm. So when he sees the man, spirit, soul, and body, Moses was able to look at that and see how that the man was made in the likeness and the image of Yahweh Elohim. You see, that's why he was able to write that. He witnessed how this spirit took up residence in Adam, you see, and Moses. He didn't know it at the time, but when he assembled this tabernacle pattern here, he didn't realize it was a reflection of his physical body.
Mm-hmm.
That was for us, you see. Because at that time, they didn't know anything about no doggone anatomy and physiology.
Right.
But what they did, what Yahweh knew, is that there were three furnishings in here, in the most holy place. There were three furnishings in the holy place. And there were three furnishings in the court round about, pointing to the man having nine systems in his body. You with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
You see, so therefore, as the Spirit, you see, takes up residence in this tabernacle and sits on the throne, you see, the Spirit also took up residence in Solomon's temple and it sits on the throne. Therefore, when you come in as a creation, the Spirit also takes up residence in you and sits on your throne.
Okay.
And just as you cannot see the Spirit or your soul sitting on your throne, likewise, these people couldn't see the Spirit that was sitting on top of this one here. You follow me?
Mm-hmm.
And when the high priest, you see, was invited up, he was also having a vision, and he was led in there. He didn't go in there physically like this. Yahweh led him in, you see, and it was Yahweh Elohim that appeared in the midst of the cloud, of course, once the service is performed correctly. Likewise, as you understand Yahshua's death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension, and outpouring of the Holy Spirit, it is Yahweh who appears in your consciousness and reveals himself to you to let you know that he is the one and he's running the show. So likewise, the priest, what he did, he also had to go in here, flicking the blood seven times towards the mercy seat, but at the end of the service, of course, you see, he would flash and appear, you see, above the mercy seat to let the priest know that the servant was performed correctly. And then he would come on out of there, you see. But the point I'm trying to get you to see, after Moses built the tabernacle, you see, he made sure everything was placed exactly in the right place. Let me just pick that up, 4th chapter of Exodus. I think it's 40 and 34. It might be 40 and 33. And 33.
And he reared up the court round, about the tabernacle and the altar.
In other words, there was curtains over here.
Mm-hmm.
You see? There was curtains over here. And remember, this tabernacle was fitted together with joints and sockets. There were no nails using this. You see? Likewise, your tabernacle is assembled together with joints and sockets. Isn't that right? You see? And you got a joint here at your shoulder.
Right.
You got a joint here at your elbow, but you also have a joint here at your hand.
Mm-hmm.
You see? So you got the arm, you know, which is your humerus. You got your ulna, you see, and your radius, you see? You see how that's making that Y right there?
Mm-hmm.
But you got three here. One, two, three appendages.
Right.
You see? You got one, two, three. You see, that's six. You got the femur, you got the tibia and the fibula. You see, but you got a joint the hip, a joint the knee, and a joint right the foot.
Mm-hmm.
You see, so what I'm trying to get you to see, there's 12 appendages gathered around your tabernacle, being a head, chest, and abdominal region, just like there are 12 tribes gathered around this tabernacle. One is pointing to the other. You see, in that there's 12 tribes, there's 12 loaves of bread, or something like this, 12 loaves of bread, six on one side, six on the other, pointing, of course, to the 12 tribes of Israel. You see, and when you come into the earth plane, it is Yahweh that takes up residence in his physical body, just like he takes up residence in his tabernacle. Keep reading.
And set up the hanging of the court gate, so Moses finished the work.
In other words, you know how a baby comes in. The first thing, of course, is made is the brain. The nervous system is formed first, correct? And then the next system is made, of course, is your circulatory system. You see? And see, just as the high priest would appear, or the Yahweh Elohim would appear in the cloud, in the midst of the cloud, when the service was performed correctly, your blood is circulating throughout your body, but you also have an arterial circle of Willis, you see, which forms a stick figure of man, which is in your blood, right, which is in your brain, which is a type and a shadow of Yahweh Elohim appearing in the midst of the brain. The point is, he is there, but you can't see him. Just as the people, they couldn't see him, neither could the priest. And when he reveals himself to you, then you know for sure that there is a Yahweh, because only Yahweh knows how to declare himself. But the second system A is a circulatory system, and that blood circulates through your body, all the way in and all the way out. And we got those nine systems right here, showing forth the nervous system, flanked by the endocrine and the reproductive system, your respiratory system, flanked by your circulatory system and your excretory system, and of course your digestive tract, which points to the foundation. You got the muscular system, and you got the skeletal system, making up the man. Nine systems point to the nine divine attributes. You see? Now, we're almost done here. Keep reading, I want to make a point.
Then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation, and the glory of Yahweh filled the tabernacle, and Moses was not able to enter into the tent of the congregation, because the cloud abode thereon, and the glory of Yahweh filled the tabernacle.
But let me tell you something, it was Moses, you see, that when he went in, he inspected, made sure everything was right, you follow what I'm saying? But when he got out, once he entered in, that was it. He couldn't go back up in there anymore. Now I'm letting you know, you see, when you come in, talking about you, you're bathed in that amniotic fluid. Just as the creation is coming in, you see, it is inundated in the waters. You see, you are that earth coming in, you are inundated in that amniotic fluid.
Right.
Or you're baptized or immersed in that fluid. You see, and also, the proof that you was immersed and baptized in that amniotic fluid, you see, when you were born, that baby have to pass a stool before they go home. Is that almost right? And that stool is called meconium. You see, and meconium is a Greek word that means, the Latin word that means lamb. You see, so let you know that each and every one of us partake of that lamb before we come into the earth plane. Likewise, all of these Israelites down here in the land of Eden, they had to eat of that lamb. You see, and that was a lamb for everybody. Likewise, you getting here, all of you guys had to partake of that lamb or that amniotic fluid before you can come up in here. You got to have that stool, and it's a greenish, blackish, greenish looking substance. You see, it don't look like the stool we have these days. It's completely different. To let you know that that is meconium, and that child partook, you see, of that amniotic fluid. You see, before they could come, you see, over here into the wilderness of Sinai. So that's a type and a shadow, you see, of the children of Israel leaving out of the land of Egypt. You see, going through the vital waters of the Red Sea, and they having a new beginning, you see, in the wilderness of Sinai. You coming out of your mother's womb is a type of you having a beginning on earth. In other words, there has to be an exodus before you can have a beginning.
you have to come out of your parents' womb
mm-hmm.
before you can have a beginning on earth.
Right.
But just as you have a beginning on earth, you have to also have an ending on earth.
Mm-hmm.
You see, you come in acting like a baby, and when you leave, guess what?
Yeah.
You see, you crawling, you grow up, but at the end of the day, as you get older, next thing you know, you're going back down. You see folks walking around, you give up one,
yeah.
and next thing you know, folks putting diapers on you, mm-hmm. Pampers and all that kind of stuff,
mm-hmm.
because your time is near.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It's just that simple.
Yeah.
And I'm letting you know, that's him coming as a thief in the night. You see, letting you know, you don't know when your time is, but I'm letting you know, and I'm going to sit down. Everybody on the earth plane, you have a beginning
mm-hmm.
and an ending.
Right.
It could be 2017 to 2030. But at the end, that is your beginning and it's your ending on life. You see, on the earth plane, because the creation came in, you see, was shown to Moses in 6 solar days, and then Yahweh entered his rest.
Mm-hmm.
You see, and the number 6, you see, points to the veil of the flesh, or that is the number of the man. You see, and in your pattern here, this veil here prevents you from seeing who you really are. We got it parted, but it's actually covered all the way up, preventing you from seeing who's really sitting on the throne.
Mm-hmm.
You may think it's the devil, but the devil ain't never sat on your throne. All
right.
thing the devil does is block your view,
mm-hmm.
prevent you from seeing.
Yeah.
And what he does, he presents the world to you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he presents the world to you. That's what deceives us, because we believe what we see.
Mm-hmm.
You see, but it has to be him in you, which is Yahweh on himself, to reveal and identify what it is you see. And on after his death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension, and outpouring of the Holy Spirit, you follow me? The mystery has been unlocked. Anything we want to know about Yahweh's divine purpose, it was made manifest on the day of Pentecost.
Mm-hmm.
Now we've been made free. And all we have to do now is be partakers of his fruits, which are these attributes, to rise in your heart, you see, and be conscious of who you are, what this thing is all about,
right.
and that's what makes you free. You're no longer ignorant about what the creation is, what
right.
death is, what the soul is, what the spirit is, where I come from, where I'm going.
Mm.
Am I going to see my parents in heaven? You'll find out even what heaven is all about.
Mm.
That's being free.
Mm.
I hope and trust you guys got something I've said today. Hallelujah.
Mm.
Truly thank the Father for allowing us to hold class this evening. We hold classes every Tuesday and Friday from 7:30 to 9:30. Sunday mornings from 11 in the morning. The fourth Sunday of every month we have a Spanish class from 9:30 in the morning to 10:45, which will be this Sunday with our Spanish class. So come back again and study with us. Bring your friends and all your enemies. Any donations will be accepted by Treasurer Dr. Lori Lawless and Stanford of Doxology. Now to him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless for the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both before all times, now and ever. Let us all say,
Hallelujah.
How are you doing, Dan?
Hey, what's going on?
Maria, I call you.
Okay.
Tomorrow.
How you doing, my man?
Tomorrow.
Okay.
Good.
I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
Oh, that's good.
Thank you.
I'll come back and do this.
I will. Good. How about yourself?
What was the question?